Hey, welcome to another Mac 7 tutorial. This is number 26. Sampling, looping, and info. Well, I'm sure that you are having a hard time just not playing around with your new sampling bass equipment and your cello, perhaps. But we do have some distance to go on this. I'm going to make a little room because we have some exciting, exciting stuff to do today. Today, we're going to make a little gadgetry that allows us to loop. As you can hear, let's just lock and switch back to that bass. It kind of points everything out right there. You know, I just want to do some funky stuff on the bass here. But all I can do is play for a quarter of a second and then I'm done. So what we want to do is kind of prolong the magic, if you will. We want to incorporate something that they call looping. And when you're looping, what you do is you find spots in your sound file that you can just make it go around and around and around in that part of the sound file. Well, you could just try to do that and set some looping points in Groove, but there's a better way to do it. So we'll do a couple things first. First, let's make Groove loop so that we can hear what that's like. So unlock your patcher, and we're going to try to set things up in a smart way. So I'm going to make the message loop, and normally I would put 1 so that that turns looping on, and then I'd make another message for loop 0 to turn it off. But this time I'm going to put string 1 so that I can just send it here. And then I run that down, loop string 1 down to Groove. And that'll turn Groove on and off with the magic output of a type the letter T. Whoop. And listen to that bass toggle. So we know that a toggle sends out a 0 and a 1. So when we turn the toggle on, it'll send loop 1. And when we turn the toggle off, it'll send loop 0. And that'll turn our toggle on and off. And then move this up a little bit because we want some other things here. If you hover your mouse around over Groove, you can see it says loop min and loop max, and that is going to correspond to the milliseconds where the best place to start the loop is and the best place to end the loop is. So what we're going to do, knowing that we're going to move forward from here, is I'm going to put a receive minimum and receive maximum here. So let's make a new object and call it receive min, and I'm going to put John after it just to make sure that I'm not receiving your minimum. I just want to receive my own minimum. And then I'm going to make another one of these called receive max John. One word. Receive objects can only stand one word, so don't put any spaces in there. But don't do stupid things like I'm doing, like min John with a capital J, and then I have a max John with a small J. That is just dumb as anything. You can't do that. I'm going to zoom in just so you can see how dumb it is. Okay, no. We're going to always, in my new nomenclature, put capital letters at the beginning of each word that I'm trying to use here. All I'm really saying is be consistent. Either use all small word letters or all capitals, but don't make it so that you can't copy them or they won't transmit to each other. So we're going to connect the receive minimum John to the left-hand inlet. Well, actually the center inlet, but the left of the two remaining. and the receive max to the right hand inlet. And then we're just going to tuck these out of the way. Indeed, we'll just duplicate them and we'll change them to send objects. Option click, move them over here, just kind of store them out of the way once we change that to S. This is a good way to make sure that they actually match each other. And we'll change that to S. And you'll notice that their outlets flip to inlets because now they're sends. Okay, so now that we've got those waiting there, we're going to move on to learning about loop. Now, as nice as base is, and I just want to play it a little more. I'm just going to lock my patcher and, hey, base, where are you? It doesn't loop very well, so I'm going to go ahead, whoops, I unlocked my patcher, and change it to cello, and then come down here. And you hear the end of cello just comes to an end, but now we're going to turn our loop on, and listen. Right, it goes around forever. But what you probably notice is that it's not very convincing. It just sounds like a tape playing over and over and over. And that's where our next object comes in and is so useful. So let's unlock our patcher. Type an N, info, and we get the info tilde sign. And what info does is report information about a sample. There it is. As we often do, let's just option click on it, get the help file, unlock the help file, copy all this stuff down here so we'll know about it, probably delete most of it in the next 5 minutes, copy, close, delete, woo! I didn't expect that when I pasted, but that's what you get. So I want it over here so that we can see it. Okay. So I guess I'm going to end up having to zoom out a little bit here. So what the help, the info object does is it tells you about a sample that is in a buffer. But remember the thing about the buffer. Our buffer is named Johnny. Our groove is named Johnny. Actually, it's not. It's named whatever you named it. But you get the idea. So here, let's get rid of some clutter here. But so we're going to change this info object to be named Johnny, or whatever you named it, Johnny, right? And of course, then it changes sizes. So I'm going to stretch it back out. There we go. And then we can see all the nice things that it will do here. And one of them, the most important, I believe, is it sends out the base frequency MIDI pitch. And another thing that info does is it sends out the sustain loop start and sustain loop end. That's gonna start sounding familiar, won't it? So let's lock our patcher and just see what it does. Now that you've changed it to this name, go up and click this button. And suddenly you get a bunch of numbers in here, and look, over here it says cello F2. It tells you that the base frequency is key number 53. Oops, I think I had made the base frequency key number 41. See, I was wrong. That's what makes the info object so great. Better than me. So, what we want to do now is send out, oops, unlock, and be careful of these. I've noticed that sometimes objects get in the way of putting your patch cords in the right place. So just pull them down out of the way. We're going to want the sustain loop start to the output, the left-hand output, to go to our send minimum whatever for our loop. And we're going to want the sustain loop end is going to be our maximum point on the loop. And I believe that if we now lock our patchers. Now we're going to send that information again, so it actually sends those numbers over to Groove Johnny. Boom. And let's see what cello sounds like now. Yeah, it just kind of vibrates on and off. More excitingly, let's say that we go up here and we change to bass. And bass, we didn't really listen to it last time, but even with loop on, well, turn it off and then listen to bass. And now turn the loop on. Yeah. It's just a really short loop that for some weird reason doesn't loop all that much, or there must be a big quiet space. But if we now report the sample information, go ahead and click this. Now when we play bass, ooh, funky. So if we can make this work with all of our, with the future sampling keys, I'm making this so complicated when I say it, but it's not really meant to be that complicated. What we want to do is every time we read something new into this buffer, what we want to do is then get the information about that sample and send it to our sampling noisemaker here. So, we already put the sends here, and we have one more send that I'm going to put here, and let's unlock our patcher, move these guys over and out of the way, because then we'll be able to collapse this and we won't have to look at it. The bass frequency MIDI pitch, which is 31, we have the frequency over here, and if we just had a receive object here, we would always be able to get this number. So let's go ahead and put yet another receive something Johnny here. So I'm going to copy this and pull it up here and say receive freak, F-R-E-Q John, and you can obviously put whatever you want, and I'm going to put that in there, and that'll always give us the bass frequency, and then I'm going to copy it by option clicking on it, dragging that over here, changing it into a send object, and connecting it. No, I'm not going to connect it to that, because first I have to do two things. One, move this out of the way. Three things. One, convert this into a frequency. So we go back to our friendly object, the MIDI to frequency, M to F, and that will give us the frequency that we want to send, and I'm just going to stick a float under it so we can always see it. I do love that bass sound. And then we're going to send that out. But I am going to put one more thing in here that I nearly forgot about, but experience teaches me that if you have a sample that doesn't have information that's accessible, it will send out a zero here. And if you send a zero out to a divide problem, it becomes an issue. So I'm going to put a select object here, new, select zero. Whoops, that's a select O. Don't type an O, a zero. Select zero. Okay, and let's connect that to the bottom of this info object. And if anything but a zero comes out, it will be converted into a frequency and sent out to this, which then gives us a base point from which to start figuring out the notes of that sample. Now, what if it is a zero? If it is a zero, we don't know anything about the note. So why don't we just guess, like a middle MIDI note is about, well, we can go ahead and find out. We'll just tap on this, go up to, I'm not locked as usual. to 0 and tap on middle C, and it's 48. That doesn't sound right. Well, okay, 48. Let's say 48 is a middling pitch for recorded things. So what we'll do, unlocking our patcher again, if it is a 0 that comes out of here, and we hope it's not, but if it is, let's just send a 48 to this so that it gets somewhere around a usable frequency. This is a kind of a worst case scenario thing here. So in the event that we get a 0, we definitely don't want a 0. So we're going to send a 48 to the M to F, MIDI to frequency, and that will send that over yonder. Okay, great. Now, finally, let's just think of one more thing, and that is we want this to be activated every time we change this, and also shortly after it loads. So I'm going to put a little, where should we put it? Does this have something that load, bang, when? Reading operation complete. There, that's exactly what we want. Buffer, bang, when file read operation complete. Perfect. So now, every time this is changed, our info is going to grab that and send all this valuable information out to our groove, allowing us to have perfect looping ability. Holy heck. And you know, the really nice thing about all of this is that we did it with send objects, so we don't even need to connect this to anything. We can just encapsulate the darn thing like this, give it a shift command E, and call that our sample info Johnny or whatever. And that's it. Our patcher right there. So let's go see, and gosh, it all almost fits on the screen now. Let's see if I can bring that stuff back over here so that we can look at it all together. Come on, mouse. There we go. Okay, back to our super duper sampler here. We have locked it, and now we're gonna play a little bit. Oh, did you hear that crackle? Oh, it's good, it's good. And let's see if cello works nicely when we do it. Very nice. Now, you've all probably noticed we only have the ability to make one note. And that means that we know what our next project is going to be. And that is going to be to put these with a poly object to make maybe 6 of these together. But before we do that, let's make one more send and receive object here, because then they'll all be together. And so right here we're gonna put a receive loop John and that will turn the loop on and off. And then we need a send loop John, which you can do by option clicking. And again, please don't use John. I don't want to have other people's patchers. Whoops, that was dumb. somehow managed to delete everything. There we go. It did it again. Oh, there it goes. Okay. So I'm just going to push this over here to the side and put a... Oh, right. And put a toggle on it. There. I like how whenever you put a toggle on, there's a accompanying sound. There we go. All right. So now we've got our loop on. We've got everything. We can pretty much encapsulate this and start moving on the next part, which is to get a poly object going with that. So here we go. Scrolling down. How much do we want to encapsulate? Maybe we'll leave the numbers out, but I'm going to grab them all to begin with. Whoops. Wasn't unlocked again. Okay, so we're going to take all this, but not these numbers. So I shift click on those and I say encapsulate. And now this is the patcher sample super sample. No, it's not super, it's just a sampler. Sample John. Okay, patcher sample John, and you've got your numbers coming in, and then like the electrosynth patcher, whoops, which I want to open and look at it, you know, we're essentially making the exact same thing, so maybe we should have saved this as Johnny Sample and just duplicate this particular piece, and I think that's what I'm going to do. So I'm going to take the old, this patcher. I'm going to say file, save as, what was the other one called? Johnny Cycle, Johnny Sampler. Oh, it's down here. Johnny Cycle. So this one's going to be Johnny Sample. And I'm saving it in my patchers. There it goes. And I close it. And then we're going to duplicate this once we unlock our patcher. We'll pull these up to here. Here, throw that away. Is that okay? No, let's not throw that away. Let's not be so bold. Let's just leave it sit there for a minute, just in case we did anything wrong. Okay, so far so good. Now we're gonna rename this one Sample Synth J. Just to avoid confusion, and we lock our patcher. We're going to open it, and you see it still has all the Johnny Cycle in there. But if we double-click, whoops, if we unlock the patcher and type Johnny Sample, that would be this one here. And now I'm just going to copy that and paste it in each one. It almost seems too easy, doesn't it? So now, using the poly object that we used in here, we've done the same thing for the new sample synth, and I mean, this is just, how could this possibly be more exciting? And I believe we could go up now here and relabel this sampler and make it the right size so that it doesn't look so dorky. There we go. And now, locking our patcher, we can try out our MIDI. We try out our electronic. And sampler, is it gonna work? No, but there's probably reasons for that. Let's load something in here so that it gets some numbers and volume. And amazingly, it still doesn't work, but I think I know what it is. In our electro synth, I notice that we have only one inlet on the Johnny cycle. And like fools, I put two inlets on the Johnny sample. So what to do, what to do, what to do? Well, I'll tell you, it's actually very simple, and we're lucky that we're so ingenious and lazy at the same time. Double-click on Johnny Sample, and you will notice that, well, you should be noticing that there's an exclamation point here. If you click on that and then click the unlock, you'll be editing the original Johnny Sample patcher. So what we want to do is put the unpack object here. Type n unpack. We want to leave two spaces for integers, so that would be space 0. And then we're going to put this line up to the bottom of that. And this cord to the right-hand outlet, and connect this inlet to the left-hand inlet of unpack, and pretty much we can throw away that second inlet. Though it might be fun to have, you never know. Anyway, so take this, save it, and magically all of your Johnny samples, or whatever you name them, Betsy sample, I bet there's something funny to... Well, anyway, have all been updated. And now, hopefully, if you lock it, you won't even have to go and just press on a key. Hopefully, it'll just work. Oh, my goodness. Just like that. All six of them. Oh, we've got polyphony. What do you call that? Polyfungus? So now, we have MIDI. Electronic and the sampler. Oops, somebody did not turn their looping on. Try that again. A much more dramatic ending. So there you go. We now have a three-mode synthesizer with looping in our sampling, and we can finally throw sample patcher sample Johnny away. And here's all we've got to clean up here, but there's more, and I will get to that in the very next tutorial. Thanks for hanging in there. Patch well. See you in the next video.